Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the University of Missouri, St. Louis. My name is Eamon Wall, and I'm the Smurfit Stone Professor of Irish Studies at OMSL Global. And this is our first event of the new academic year, 2021-22. And before introducing our performers today and welcoming them to our program, I want to first give thanks to the staff and director at OMSL Global. Bob L has been in charge of putting this program together for us, both the contracts and the technology and all of the other parts that are involved in it. And we are also thankful to our executive director, Leanna Constantine, for her efforts for this program. I also would like to remind you of some forthcoming events this semester and this academic year. On October 12th, we will do a book launch of Famine Pots with Padraig Kerwin and Leanne Howe. And this is a book that commemorates the connections between the Choctaw Nation and Ireland from the famine to the present. That will be at 12:30 on October 12th. On November 9th, Don Corrigan, a local journalist here in St. Louis, a distinguished journalist, will speak on Northern Ireland, specifically on his visits to Northern Ireland on fellowship. And he will talk about the troubles and the conflict, specifically about the murals in Belfast. Next semester, on April 16th, we will have our annual gala concert in the Tuil Performing Arts Center this year featuring Martin Hayes. So that will be on April 16th in the Lee Theater. And also in 2022, we will resume our study abroad program at NUI Galway. So that will run in June and July of next year. If you need any information about any of these events, please feel free to contact me. You can use the chat here today, or you can email me at walle@umsl.edu. So our event today, we are very excited to have Celtic Knots join us for a performance entitled W.B. Yeats and Maud Gonne, A Love Affair. And of course, it's a love affair between two great Irish people, a great Irish man and a great Irish woman. But it also celebrates, I think, the great contributions that both Yeats and Maud Gonne made in terms of politics and in terms of making Ireland a better place for everybody, including writers and musicians. And Celtic Knots comprises three performers. Brian Bigley, who's a multi-instrumentalist and also a dancer who lives in Cleveland, Ohio. And just recently, his fourth CD has come out, Dance the Town Green. So Brian, you're most welcome. And also then Tomáseen Foley, who has had two CDs, A Celtic Christmas and The Priest and the Acrobat. And Tom lives nowadays in California, and he has performed not just in Ireland and in the US, but worldwide, like many of Irish music performers nowadays. And he's had a distinguished career in the Irish arts field in the US. And our final performer is Eimear Arkins, who lives nowadays in St. Louis. She, of course, if you're familiar with our program, she has performed for us before. We invite her back again because she's part of Celtic Knots, but we know that because she's so good. And she has also performed internationally with various ensembles, including the Paul Brock Band, Cherish the Ladies, and others. And while she is here in St. Louis, she also teaches Irish Music and Song for St. Louis Irish Arts. And St. Louis Irish Arts is a we are proud to co-sponsor many events with St. Louis Irish Arts. So everybody, audience, you are most welcome to the beginning of our program. The performance today will run for an hour approximately, and we'll follow that with some questions and answers. And then if we have a little bit of time at the end, then we will have a final tune to send us on our way. So enough of me. A big welcome, a big St. Louis welcome to Celtic Knots.
Down by the Sally Gardens, my love and I did meet. She passed the Sally Gardens with little snow. She bid me take love easy as the leaves grow on the tree. But I, being young and foolish, with her would not agree. In a field down by the river, my love and I would stand, and on my leaning shoulder she placed her snow-white hand. She bid me take life easy as the grass grows on the winds. But I was young and foolish, and now am full of tears.
So catastrophic were the years of the Great Famine in Ireland that Irish poets, writers, musicians, singers, and storytellers all fell silent. It looked like every trace of Irish culture was being erased. Even the Irish themselves were thought to be a vanishing race. But 13 years after the worst of the famine, a great bell boomed triumphantly over the country to break the silence and to announce the birth of a man who was to be a poet, playwright, Nobel laureate, senator, a sorcerer, a magician, who within the span of his own lifetime was destined to reinvigorate, some would say reinvent, Ireland's artistic and cultural life, loosely based on the old Gaelic culture that had flourished for 1,000 years before the arrival of the English. And he would do so not in the traditional Irish language, but in English. While still in his mid-20s, he wrote poetry that will stand as long as the English language stands. All of Gaelic Ireland's ancient preoccupation with poetry, music and song seemed to speak once more through his lips. One evening, walking in the rain down a busy street in London, his mind slipped back to the west of Ireland, to a lake in the Shannon River to a small island in the Lake Isle of Innisfree. I will arise and go now, and go to Innisfree, and a small cabin build there of clay and wattles made. 9 bean rows will I have there, and a hive for the honey bee, and live alone in the bee loud glade. And I shall have some peace there, for peace comes dropping slow, dropping from the veils of the morning to where the cricket sings. There, midnight's all a glimmer and noon a purple glow, and the evening full of the linnet's wings. I will arise and go now, for always night and day I hear lake water lapping with low sounds by the shore. While I stand on the roadway or on the pavements grey, I hear it in the deep heart's core. Welcome back. I'm just finding my place here. I'll be with you in just a moment. In the year 1889, when he was 24 years old, William Butler Yeats was introduced to a woman who, as he put it when he first saw her, was luminous as apple blossom through which the light falls. Speaking afterwards about that first meeting, he said, "It was then that the troubling of my life began." She was 23, a wealthy heiress from British aristocracy, a writer, an actress, a woman of exceptional courage and extraordinary beauty. She was 6 feet tall, bronze-haired, with melancholy eyes, a look that placed her amongst the great beauties of the age. She'd had several proposals before she turned 18. Legend has it that when King Edward VII of England was Prince of Wales, he saw her and longed to marry her. Despite her being English by birth and ancestry, she had been raised and educated in Paris, Dublin, and Italy. But astoundingly, she was to become a radical Irish nationalist, an authentic, genuine revolutionary, a firebrand, a suffragette, a feminist, when the word had scarcely been heard of. Yeats's biographer, Roy Foster, writes that both her appearance and character represented tragic passion. This surely was a woman for Yeats. She became the subject and object of his infatuation across several decades, the furnace that fired his poetry of yearning. She may have been one of the greatest influences in his life, and his life would be among the single greatest influences in the creation of modern Ireland. For the next 25 years, in the furnace of his devotion to her, he fashioned glorious poetry, wrote plays with Maud sometimes in the starring role, plays that were the foundation stone of Ireland's national theatre, the Abbey, which he co-founded. She became for him Ireland's Helen of Troy, Dublin's own Joan of Arc. For him, she was the living embodiment of the spirit of the new Ireland he wanted to create. Had I the heavens' embroidered cloths, inwrought with golden and silver light, the blue and the dim and the dark cloths of night and light and the half-light, I would spread the cloths under your feet. But I, being poor, have only my dreams. I have spread my dreams under your feet. Tread softly, because you tread on my dreams. In Dublin, in 1891, two years after they met, Yeats proposed marriage to Maud for the first time. Maud declined. 8 years later, while they were in Westminster Abbey in London, standing beside the coronation stone, the stone of destiny, which Maud claimed England had stolen from Ireland by way of Scotland, and she wanted it returned, he proposed to her again. And again, Maud declined. He proposed to her yet again the following year, and again in 1917. But Maud was not to be moved. So 25 years elapsed between his first proposal to her and his last. And today, at the National Library of Ireland in Dublin, under airtight glass, is a notebook given to Yeats in 1908 by Maud Gonne. It contains their many letters to each other, bound in white vellum. It serves, Roy Foster, their biographer, says, as their metaphysical martial bed. Yeats used it to keep track of their shared fixations with the occult and with each other. Now, a century later, that book is on display. Every syllable, every comma, every curve of their handwriting is there. And next to the display case, the entire notebook has been digitally reincarnated. So with the stroke of a finger on a touchscreen, a visitor can flip through their pages written to each other 100 years ago. One of the most unforgettable poems he wrote to her, that book, that same book, is mentioned in the second line, or at least I've chosen to presume that he is referring to that book. When you are old and grey and full of sleep and nodding by the fire, take down this book and slowly read and dream of the soft look your eyes had once and of their shadows deep. How many loved your moments of glad grace and loved your beauty with love false or true? But one man loved the pilgrim soul in you and loved the sorrows of your changing face. And bending down beside the glowing bars, murmur a little sadly how love fled and paced upon the mountains overhead and hid his face amid a crowd of stars. Maud Gonne, in many ways, was 100 years ahead of her time. She was a fully fledged Irish patriot and an outspoken one. And Yeats, notwithstanding the fact that he and she came from a class of people who seemed to have nothing to gain and everything to lose from a free Ireland, in his own idiosyncratic way, he supported the Irish nationalist cause, though some debated whether he did so from conviction or from his love for Maud. His intensely nationalistic play, Cathleen Houlihan, in which Ireland is represented as a woman, likely was inspired, at least in part, by Maud. And Maud played the title role when the play was first produced at the Abbey in Dublin. By all accounts, she was mesmerising. Yet, on reading her autobiography, notwithstanding the mystical marriage she felt she had with Yeats, one is left with the feeling that she did not, or perhaps could not, fully acknowledge or accept the depth of his feelings for her. For example, around this time he wrote in his diary, "If I could go to her and prove by putting my hand in the fire until I had burnt it badly, that not make her understand that devotion of mine should not be thrown away." Though you are in your shining days, voices among the crowd, and new friends busy with your praise, be not unkind or proud, but think about old friends the most. Time's bitter flood will rise, your beauty perish and be gone for all eyes but these eyes.
Thank you.
During the 9 years after they first met, from 1889 to 1898, despite the frenetically busy lives they each led, Maud mostly in Paris, Yeats between England and Ireland, through an almost non-stop flow of letters, as well as meeting each other as often as they could in Paris, London and Dublin, they developed an extraordinarily intimate and intense relationship. So 9 years after he first fell headlong for her, 9 years during which he wrote poems and plays inspired by her, 9 years during which she had declined all his proposals of marriage, notwithstanding all that, it wasn't until they were by the fireside at the Crown Hotel in Dublin that she kissed him on the lips for the very first time. Or, as he wrote afterwards, it was the first time she kissed me with bodily mouth. It was there, by that same fireside, Maud confessed that through all those 9 years she had known Yeats, she had been living another life, a secret life, a life so secret that neither Yeats nor a single one of her friends or family knew anything about it. She confessed that the year after their first encounter in London in 1889, she had given birth to a baby boy. She confessed that 5 years later, in 1894, she had given birth to a baby girl. She confessed that some years before she met Yeats, when she was 21, she had met a 37-year-old French politician called Lucien Milvaux. She confessed that he, Milvaux, was already married when she met him and already had a son, and that he, Milvaux, was the father of her two children. Never give all the heart, for love will hardly seem worth thinking of to passionate women if it seems certain. And they never dream that it fades out from kiss to kiss, for everything that's lovely is but a brief, dreamy, kind delight. Oh, never give the heart outright. For they, for all smooth lips can say, have given their hearts up to play. And who could play it well enough if deaf and dumb and blind with love? He that made this knows all the cost, for he gave all his heart and lost. Thank you. Maud Gonne campaigned tirelessly for the cause of Irish freedom. Her aristocratic bearing and background notwithstanding, the suffering of the downtrodden, the poor, the hungry, the oppressed, and the dispossessed, especially the suffering of children, the weight of it all brought Maud down from her high horse and tuck her into the hovels of the Irish poor. And once inside, she openly exhorted them to take up arms against our English oppressors. Her advocacy for the violent overthrow of English rule in Ireland greatly troubled Yeats and caused a deep and abiding rift between them. Yet when Yeats's fame as a poet was growing and he was becoming a well-known figure, Maud was still recognised more for being his muse than for her own Trojan work. But in 1903, long after her troubled relationship with the Frenchman had ended, Maud did finally accept a marriage proposal. It came from a man who, for her, had the most seductive of all possible manly qualities, perhaps the one manly quality she could not resist. He was wanted by the British authorities for seditious activities. His name was Major John MacBride. At their wedding, Maud, who was now known to give her her full name in the Irish language, she was known as Maud Ní Gonn Ban Magula Vrida, raised her glass and toasted to the complete independence of Ireland. Her marriage, it seemed, may have been to Ireland. But now, more than ever before, she seemed to have betrayed Yeats's desperate devotion to her, for she had given him little forewarning of her marriage. He heard about it from a mutual friend. Yet perhaps it can be said that Yeats's suffering came not from the fact that he didn't understand Maud, but one wonders if, when he looked at her, whether it was Maud he saw or Helen of Troy. Why should I blame her that she filled my days with misery, or that she would of late have taught to ignorant men most violent ways, or hurled the little streets upon the great, had they but courage equal to desire? What could have made her peaceful with a mind that nobleness made simple as a fire, with beauty like a tightened bow, a kind that is not natural in an age like this? Being high and solitary and most stern, why, what could she have done being what she is? Was there another Troy for her to burn? As almost everyone who knew them had predicted, Maud's marriage to John McBride didn't last long, though it lasted long enough for them to have a son, Sean. Inevitably, in her distress, Maud turned to Yeats, or Willie, as she called him. And equally inevitably, Yeats could not resist. So they rekindled the notion of a spiritual marriage, though researchers now believe that this time their relationship, at least for a brief interlude, may for the first time have been physical as well as spiritual. Yeats became a father figure of sorts to Maud's daughter, Isolde, who was now a teenager. Maud did not even now publicly acknowledge that Isolde was, in fact, her daughter. For the rest of her life, she referred to Isolde as my adopted child. Many thought incorrectly that Yeats was Isolde's father. One of his loveliest poems, To a Child Dancing in the Wind, was inspired by Isolde. And 2 years later, after he wrote that first poem to her, he wrote another called 2 Years Later. Dance there upon the shore, what need have you to care for wind or water's roar, and tumble out your hair that the salt drops have wet? Being young, you have not known the fool's triumph, nor yet love lost as soon as won, nor the best labourer dead, and all the sheaves to bind. What need have you to dread the sorrowing of the wind? And this, his second poem, also inspired by Isolde, called 2 Years Later. Has no one said those daring, kind eyes should be more learned, or warned you how despairing the moths are when they are burned? I could have warned you, but you are young, and so I speak a different tongue. Oh, you will take whatever's offered and dream that all the world's a friend. Suffer as your mother suffered, be as broken in the end. But I am old and you are young, and I speak a barbarous tongue. In Dublin, at 11 a.m. on Easter Monday morning, 1916, teachers, actors, writers, idealists, dreamers and ordinary workers, few of them with any military experience, but all with rebellion in their hearts, took up arms against the might of the British Empire and declared Ireland a republic, free and independent of empire and crown. This was the culmination of 800 years of Ireland's fight for freedom, everything that Maud had dreamed of and worked for. Although neither she nor Yeats had even the faintest presentiment that all around them, every day, this historic moment had been in the planning for years. Initially, the rebellion was quelled with a massive show of British force. Many of its leaders were captured, hastily court-martialed, and unceremoniously and tragically executed by firing squad. Among those executed was Major John MacBride, Maud's long estranged husband and father of their son, Sean. As MacBride stood before the firing squad at 4 o'clock in the morning, he said, "Fire away. I've been looking down the barrels of rifles all my life." Maud had separated from John MacBride 10 years previous, not too long after their marriage, in fact, but had not been granted a divorce, and in any event, as far as the Catholic Church was concerned, separated or not, she remained married to him. After his death, she wore the black mourning clothes of a widow for the rest of her life. Maud was never to be found wanting when it came to the grand theatrical gesture. But, of course, now she was free to marry again. And in the summer of 1917, of course, Yeats proposed to her again. And, of course, Maud declined again. Throughout his life, Yeats was much influenced, if not almost entirely guided, by the unseen world, the world of mysticism, magic, and the occult. Now, in his early 50s, guided by those same astrological lights, he thought it absolutely imperative that he be married before the end of 1917, which left him only a few months to get the job done, so to speak. So, almost immediately after Maud declined his proposal, and with her clear and explicit permission, he proposed to Isolde, Maud's daughter, now aged 22. Isolde, too, eventually, though very reluctantly, declined. Perhaps Maud could be forgiven if she felt relieved that her erstwhile lover was not to be her son-in-law after all. But Yeats, with no time to waste, the astrological clock was ticking ominously, and propelled by his deeply held belief that this was by far the most propitious time for him to get married. A few weeks later, while still obsessed with his love for Isolde, he issued proposal number 3, all these within the same month. This one to a wealthy 25-year-old English heiress called Georgiana Hyde Lees. Well, we can all breathe a sigh of relief when we learn that though Georgiana was well aware that Yeats had been burning his way through a lengthy proposal list, and she was well aware too of her lowly place on that same list, still, she accepted, and with Maud's and Isolde's approval, Yeats and Georgiana were married a whole 3 weeks later, in October 1917. His best man was the American poet as a pound. And despite its being so hastily formed, their union was a happy one. They had two children, Michael and Anne. In 1923, Yeats was awarded the Nobel Prize for Literature. The citation reads, in part, "For his always inspired poetry, which in a highly artistic form gives expression to the spirit of a whole nation." Maud remained a widow for the rest of her life and faithfully continued her work for the poor and the oppressed, and especially the imprisoned. At the age of 52, she herself was imprisoned for 6 months in Her Majesty's Royal Holloway Prison in London. She was accused of being involved in a pro-German plot against England. On the day she was arrested, as the police drove away from her house with Maud inside, she looked back and saw her 14-year-old son, Sean, running down the street after the car. This scene haunted them both for years to come. When she was arrested again in 1923, this time by the Irish Free State government, she insisted on taking her dog to prison with her. And then she went on hunger strike and was released a few weeks later. And notwithstanding her privileged place in the world, some aspects of her life were tinged with tragedy. Her first son, whom she had with the Frenchman Millevaux, died before he reached 2 years of age. In her will, she asked that his baby shoes be buried with her, and they were. Sean McBride, the son of Maud and John, those two rebellious firebrands, took a very different course with his life. He went from being chief of staff of the IRA to being a founding member of Amnesty International and served as its chairman. In 1974, he was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize. Due to their opposing political beliefs, Maud and Yeats were occasionally estranged, sometimes for long periods. Yet, in a manner of speaking, it could be said they remained friends. Their final meeting was in Dublin at Yeats's home in 1938. He died a year later in France, aged 73. That same year, he wrote, "How can I, that girl standing there, my attention fixed on Roman or on Russian or on Spanish politics? Yet here's a travelled man that knows what he talks about, and there's a politician that has both thought and read. And maybe what they say is true of war and war's alarms. But oh, that I were young again and held her in my arms." Thank you. All right. Are we done, Eamon?
Yes. Thank you very much, Tomáseen Foley, Eimear Arkins, and Brian Bigley. What a tremendous performance. And we have a little bit of time for some questions and answers. So if anybody would like to pose a question to any of our performers today, you can just put it in the Q&A part at the bottom middle of your screen, and then I will read the questions out to the performers, and they will answer them. And so while you're thinking of your questions and your comments and your thoughts, I will just fill in the time by making a few of my own. And so we had this wonderful music and the spoken word and song and poetry. And I think it's a kind of the full range in some ways of Irish artistic endeavors, and a wonderful way, I think, to celebrate our heritage and culture and to begin our academic year here at UMSL. Thinking of Maud Gonne, I remember hearing the old people when I was a child talk about seeing Maud Gonne come into the village of Coolgranny just after householders had been evicted from their property by the landlord, and she came to support them. And she rode into town, into the village, on a white horse, you know, like somebody out of a classical tale, you know, and just mesmerized everybody. I suppose for all of us, Yeats's poems are part of our childhood. I mean, from primary school, we learned the Lake Isle of Innisfree, and then in secondary school, we do, among others, the Easter 1916, that both poems that Tom read for us this afternoon. The tunes, we recognize some of them. And so I think the tunes and the poems for Irish people in Ireland and as part of the Irish diaspora are part of the soundtrack of our lives in many ways. And sometimes, as in Eimear doing at the beginning down by the Sally Gardens, the tunes and the poems and the songs all come together, you know. So these were terrific performances and very, very evocative. So I am looking in the Q&A, and I don't see any questions. So it means that everybody is very shy. In the chat, Kathleen has put in that she is totally mesmerized. Thank you very much. So it could be that our audience have been so mesmerized that they are unable to respond, right? That they have, which is a great compliment to the performers. So Bridget Crane writes in to say, wonderful, wonderful performance. So I'm going to ask one question then and I'm going to start with Brian and then go to Tom and then go to Eimear to talk a little bit about your beginnings as artists. Sandy has written in to say, the poetry brought me to tears, so lovely. Yeah, thank you, Sandy. So I'm going to ask this question to Brian and to Tom and to Eimear, because we will have a number of our students who are here today listening and watching, and many of them maybe are beginning to get involved in performance. So maybe each of you would have an anecdote, you know, to give to our students or anybody in our audience who's thinking about being a musician or a poet or a singer. So first you, Brian.
Thanks, Eamon. Yeah. I'm born of Irish descent here on the west side of Cleveland, but neither of my parents played music or or were involved in the Irish arts by any means, but I had some neighbors growing up that were deeply into traditional music and dance, and would go hop across the street to go to some sessions, some house sessions, people playing music, and you know, telling jokes and stories a number of times, and they were visceral experiences for me. You know, the house just came alive with this fantastic music and dance, and you know, there was tea and scones, and there were these two old fellas from Sligo that that lived here in Cleveland, and they played the flute and the fiddle. The fiddle player was called Tom McCaffrey, and Tom Burns was the flute player. In fact, if you go to the traditional music archives in the Smithsonian, there's a recording of them playing. And anyways, then things started coming out, like Riverdance and Lord of the Dance, where you could hear the pipes, and I just became enthralled with the sound of the pipes at a very young age, and found in high school that I could make a couple of bucks doing it by playing in bars and things like that. And so so my interest became even deeper into it, and realized that if I was going to play the pipes in any professional capacity, I would have to be able to make my own reeds, because you couldn't just go down to the nearest music store and get a replacement reed or find somebody to help you get your set of pipes in tune. So after high school, I started working for a fella called Seth Gallagher, who is a prolific Illan pipes maker in upstate New York, and worked for him for a few years, and worked for a flute maker called Patrick Olwell down in Virginia for a while. And then not long after that, I got hooked up with Tom in my early 20s, and started going on the road and listening to his stories. And it's funny, because his stories about growing up in Limerick, you know, back in the 50s, I suppose, he talks about getting the neighbors would get together and they would play music for each other, much less of a performance than just a sharing of the music and community. And it's that kind of feeling that is just electric, and it gets people connected, you know. And so that's kind of how I fell in love with playing music and performing and dancing, you know, hope to do it justice as I go on.
Okay. All right. Thanks so much, Brian. So that's a nice segue into you, Tom, because Brian eventually got involved in performing with you, right?
He did, yeah. So I grew up in West Limerick on a small farm where my family had been for a couple hundred years and still are. And, you know, the neighbours played. There were no musicians in my family, really, but there were some good storytellers, my mother chief amongst them. So I grew up, you know, hearing music and hearing really good sort of natural storytellers. And that's kind of what set me on my way when I was in my early 40s, I think. I changed life and career completely and took off on this other road, and started the process of becoming a storyteller. And gradually from that, I developed shows. One is a Christmas show called A Celtic Christmas. And the other is a show we do with Brian around St. Patrick's called The Rambling House. And they both feature Irish music, singing and dancing. But I think we are possibly the only show that has storytelling at its center, and everything revolves around the storytelling.
Okay, all right. Thank you. Well, it's good for us that you made that career change, right? And you know, so thank God for that. And In the meantime, Colleen and Rose and Bill have contributed to the chat to say how much they've enjoyed the performance in all parts of it. So finally, Eimear, then, how did you get started in music and singing?
Well, I hope I won't offend you or Tom here by saying that I grew up in the home of music in County Clare, surrounded by it. And so I started taking lessons when I was about five with Frank Custy in Tuna Hall. And I'd started dancing before that, and neither of my parents played, but they were very interested in getting me and my brother music lessons when the time came along, and I had begged for Irish dancing lessons. So just got started, and I was lucky to be in a community that was rich with musicians, and there were lots of opportunities to perform as a youngster. I used to go into Cushnahowna in Ennis. I started going in there when I was about eight, I think, with one of my best friends from school. Her dad, who has sadly since passed away, Brian Pryor, would have the two of us on stage, and we'd play our two tunes or whatever we knew, and that was it, you know, and it was great. There'd be touring Americans that would come to see these shows, and we would maybe dance, or I might sing a song or play a couple of tunes. And I got started then, and then spent many summers in Chocheol in Curraghfin, performing for visitors and for locals alike. Though we would do a show there for eight shows a summer usually. And started there as a kid and grew up in it. So I was kind of performing from probably age eight or nine, and it gave me so many opportunities to travel. My dad is also a storyteller and a singer, and we took to the road ourselves a couple of times with different groups, with Coltas Cultury Éireann and with an Irish Rambling House as well, throughout the UK, and eventually went to America and Canada too. So I just grew up performing, and now here I am in America performing for more Americans and people all over the world. So it's been good to me. The Irish music has been very good to me.
And you're also teaching the next generation of musicians here in St. Louis, right? Carry on the tradition.
Yeah, carrying on the tradition and performing with them as well, which is always a lot of fun. It's great to see all the hard work come to fruition when they're on stage and making all the mammies and daddies smile and proud.
Okay. And again, thanks to everybody for the comments in the chat. They're all very positive, and we're thrilled to hear from you, and we're absolutely thrilled to be able to have these performances. We have one part of the program left to go, and but before I ask our performers, or at least one of our performers, to play us out with a tune, let me just take this opportunity to thank our performers today from Celtic Knots for a wonderful hybrid and excellent performance of song and music and spoken word and recitation and storytelling and all of that. If you would like any information more about our programs, as I said, you can always email me at walle@umsl.edu. Our next event will be on October 12th, Famine Pots, about the Irish famine and connections between Ireland and Native America. That will be at the same time on October 12th. And so thanks, everybody. And thanks, everybody, also at UMSL Global for making all of this possible. And now a final thanks to Celtic Knots. And somebody in Celtic Knots is going to end this occasion by playing us out. I'm not sure who it is, but whoever it will be,
it will be
wonderful.
Thanks so much for having us, Eamon. And it's really a delight to be here. And it's always great to work with Eimear and Tom. And, you know, it's easy to look good standing next to those two, so... so I'm gonna play a couple of dance tunes here, and for those people that are interested, there's a recording of some of the things that we played today on an album called Celtic Knots, and As Eamon said, if you're looking for any information, feel free to contact him.
Well done, Brian.
Thanks again, guys. A lot of fun.
Okay. Thank you, performers, and thank you, audience. And look forward to seeing you all again soon. And everybody, be happy and be safe. All right.
Thanks. Bye-bye. See you again.
Bye-bye. Thanks so much, Eamon. Okay. Bye-bye now. Bye-bye.
You're welcome.
Bye-bye, bye-bye. Everyone. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.